Dear students, welcome to physics class. I am Dr. J.C. Babu, Assistant Professor of Physics from Vivekananda Government Degree College. Today we are going to discuss about nuclear detectors. As we are discussing about the nuclear structure, nuclear radioactivity, now we are going to discuss about the nuclear detectors. How we have to detect the nuclear radiation coming out from the nucleus. For this, I am going to share PowerPoint presentation. So, here, today's topics are first, introduction to nuclear detectors, gas field detectors, proportional counter, Geiger-Müller counter, GM counter, scintillation counter, and Wilson cloud chamber. Finally, we will discuss about the solid state detectors. So, nuclear detectors are used, the instruments are used to detect the nuclear radiation. The nuclear radiation in terms of their nature and their energy. So that the instruments which are used to detect the particles of nuclear radiation to estimate their energies and to know about their nature are called the nuclear detectors. So nuclear detectors are simply used to detect the nuclear radiation, about their nature, their energy, their ionization power, their penetration power, their range of the nuclear radiation, their track of the nuclear radiation, so that for detect all this, we need a instrument called the nuclear detectors. But for the basis of, for all the detector is ionization. So the ionization is basis for the most of the detectors to detect the particles or radiation. These detectors are capable of counting number of particles per second, intensity of radiation and energy as well. So that based on the ionization process, these most of the detectors will work. So using this ionization process, the all detectors are capable of counting the number of particles passing per second, and intensity of radiation and energy, all this we will discuss. So these detectors are classified into four categories, is electronic detectors. Under this, ionization chamber, proportional counter, GM counter and semiconductor counters comes under electric detectors. Second is optical detectors. Here, scintillation counters, Krenkov counters will come under this category. And others are photographic emulsions and like cloud chamber, bubble chamber, spark chamber. Like this, the detectors are classified. We will discuss about one by one. First, gas field detectors. Here you see this, in this detector, the gas is filled, inert gas is filled, and we apply the voltage. When you apply the high voltage, the gas will ionize. So that we will see the construction of this gas filled detector. The gas filled detector comprises of metallic cylinder. So this is the metallic cylinder chamber, and centrally conducting thin wire. This is the conducting thin wire. The cylinder acts as a cathode. Here a cylinder itself acts as a cathode and wire acts as a anode. If you see here, this is connected to cylinder, cylinder cathode, and the central wire is connected to the anode. So that central wire acts as the anode, cylinder acts as a cathode. Now how it will works, we will see. When the radiation enters to the detector, you see here alpha and beta rays are entering into this detector. What happens? Ionization of gas takes place. Due to this, ions formed and collected by the respective electrodes. If positive is collected by the anode and negative collected by the cathode. These ions are fed to electrical circuit which gives the counts. So that the counts will increase when these collected by the respective electrodes. With increasing of the voltage between these two electrodes, different events took place in the chamber. So that these different events, when we are increasing the voltage, so many events will occur in this chamber. So that we will discuss in detail. So here, the first reason, if you observe the graph between the charge collected in log scale versus voltage applied in linear scale, when voltage is increasing, we see so many regions of the graph. So here the regions are divided like this. First region up to this region is called recombination region, next ionization region, proportional region, limited proportional region, and Geiger-Müller region, finally continuous discharge. We will discuss one by one. First region is recombination region. In this region, the applied voltage is too low. The voltage is low so that the ion pairs produced by the ionization of gas recombines before reaching the electrodes. So here the ionization takes place is very low, so that the recombination takes place before these ions reaching these electrodes. So that as the applied voltage is increased, more number of ions move fastly towards the electrode. Initially, this charge collection is zero because of no voltage applied. When voltage slowly increasing, the ionization takes place. When the voltage is increases, more number of ions reaches the electrodes, so that here the counting is increasing. Therefore, this region is called the recombination region, because recombination takes place before reaching the ion recombination takes place before reaching the electrodes. And the second region is called the ionization region, indicates this region. In this region, when the applied voltage is slightly increased, the recombination of charge carriers is reduced and the ion pairs moves towards the electrode. Here the ion pairs will move towards the electrode. The pulse size or counts remains constant up to a certain voltage. You see, the pulse size or this one is continuous up to a certain voltage. So that here the count is not increasing. this is parallel region. So that this region is called the ionization chamber region or saturation region. We can call as the saturation region. When again voltage is increasing, the region comes under the limited proportion region. Here the applied voltage is sufficiently high so that the electrons liberated by the ionizing event get sufficient energy to cause secondary emission. Here the secondary emission takes place. Due to secondary ionization results in the increasing of the collected charge. So you can see that here the count is drastically increasing due to the secondary ionization. In this pulse height depends on the initial ionizing event. Greater the ionizing power of initial ionizing particle, greater is the pulse height. This region is called the proportional region. And if the voltage increased behind the proportional region, here behind the proportional region, the pulse height is not proportional to the applied voltage. This indicates the production of large number of secondary ions. This is known as the limited proportionality or non-proportionality region. This is limited proportionality region or non-proportionality region. Again, the voltage is further increased. The pulse height is completely independent of initial ionization, and all particles produce pulses of same height irrespective of the energy and primary ionization. So in this region, the pulse height is independent, completely independent of the initialization. All particles produce pulse of same height irrespective of energy and primary ionization. So that this region is called the Geiger-Müller region. And above the Geiger-Müller region, continuous discharge takes place in the detector by producing the large number of the pulses, so that this region is called the continuous discharge or sparkling region. So that from this, how the ionization takes place in the gas filled detector or in a cylinder, if ionization takes place, how many events will occur, we can get from this discussion. So now in this region, different portions of this graph will use by the different counters. Like if you use the proportional region, that we can call as the proportional counter, or if you use the GM region or Geiger-Müller region, that is by Geiger-Müller counter. So that we will discuss like proportional counter and Geiger-Müller counters in detail. First, proportional counter. This is the block diagram of the proportional counter. As we seen in a gas filled counter is same like that, but we are using only the region of proportional region. Here also proportional counter consists of cylinder, metal cylinder chamber, as we discuss in the gas filled counter, and cylinder acts as a cathode. And here also central wire consisting of central wire along the axis of the cylinder acts as the anode wire. And this wire is connected to the positive terminal of a battery of a high voltage, and high tension battery, and serves as a negative terminal of high tension battery is connected to the metal chamber. and high resistance R is connected in a series with battery circuit. The wire is in turn connected to pulse amplifier and counting circuit. It is connected to counting circuit. And tube is also provided with a mica window so that ionizing radiation can enter into it. The chamber is filled with gas for a particular purpose at a suitable atmospheric pressure. The proportional counter functions satisfactorily at voltages 500 to 800 volts at pressure about 1 atmosphere. So we use only 500 to 800 volts depending on the that voltage and ionization counter characteristics. It works firmly between 500 to 800 volts at about 1 atmosphere. As you know, now we will see the working of this proportional counter. When the radiation enters into this chamber, ionization takes place. You know, they produce positive and negative charges due to ionization. Due to the applied voltage, they acquire much energy, and again they produce additional ionization by collision with these gas molecules. Already the gas this is filled with the gas, so that first due to voltage they get ionized, and these electrons and positive charges again produce the secondary ionization by colliding the gas molecules in this chamber. So that due to the secondary ionization, the number of ions produced will be large. So that number of secondary ions reaching the central wire is known as the multiplication factor. If small e is the amount of charge created by the direct interaction of incident radiation in the gas which is filled, and small n is the gas multiplication factor, so small e is the initial charge produced by the ionization, and small n is the gas multiplication factor, then total charge capital Q collected on electrodes is capital Q is equal to NE, or we can say that Q is proportional to E. This is the basic proportional per counter. The value of N may vary from 1 to 10 power 6 depending on the characteristics of counter. Since multiplication factor is constant up to certain voltage, this region is called as proportional region. The parameters, the operators, and all operating in this region is called the proportional counter. So that since the central wire is very thin, potential difference is large, the electrical field E is equal to dV by dr at a distance r from the center is very high. If small b is the radius of the cylinder and the radius of the wire, the radial field capital E at a distance small r from the center wire is given by E is equal to V by R log E to E V by A, where A is applied voltage between the central wire and the outer cylinder. So that here it works under the proportionality region. The operator operating this region is called the proportional counter. Since multiplication factor is constant and up to certain voltage, and this region is called the proportional region, the operator works under this region is called the proportional counter. The principle is same. When the radiation enters into this proportional counter, takes as ionization, these ionization in turn produce this secondary ionization, so that number of counts is proportional to the multiplication factor and ionization produced in this gas filter. Q is proportional to E and Q is equal to NE. Now we can discuss the advantages and disadvantages of the proportional counter. Advantages: the proportional counter is capable of distinguish between alpha, beta and gamma particles by virtue of their pulse height. The height gives a measure of the energy of instant particle. Second, it is also used to detect uncharged neutrons by filling with boron trifluoride. Third, this detector is quite useful in detecting beta particles having low ionization power and also in estimating their energies, so that it is used to detect the beta particles because having low ionization power, and also we can estimate this using this, we can estimate the energies of the beta. And fourth, it is also used in measuring the particles of flow rate. We can measure the flow rate of the particles. The disadvantages are: the proportionality factor depends on the applied voltage, and hence the applied voltage should be maintained at a constant value, so that here the proportionality counter not depends on the radiation, it depends on the applied voltage, so that we should apply constant voltage. Now we will discuss about the Geiger-Müller counter. So this is the block diagram of the Geiger-Müller counter. It consists of metal wire, metal chamber C containing a gas at a pressure about 10 centimeter of mercury. So here this chamber, you see, this is a metal chamber C, acts as a cathode, you know, and this chamber is filled with the gas at the atmosphere about the 10 centimeter of mercury. This gas is a mixture of 90% argon and 10% ethyl alcohol, so that this is the mixture of argon and ethyl alcohol, 90% of argon and 10% of ethyl alcohol taken into the chamber. Here you see a fine wire, this is a central wire made with tungsten W, is kept along the axis, of the tube, and insulated by ebonite plug. This is the ebonite plug EE, and this wire is connected to the, you see, this wire is connected to the positive terminal of high tension battery. This is the high tension battery. This wire is connected to positive, and the cylinder is connected to the negative. This wire is connected to positive terminal of high tension battery through the high resistance R. This resistance is 100 mega ohms, and the DC voltage is kept slightly less than that which will cause a discharge between the electrodes. So this is high tension is kept slower than the voltage causes the discharge between the electrodes. So this is the construction of the Geiger-Müller counter. Here the chamber C is filled with the gas of 90% argon and 10% ethyl alcohol, and the central wire is connected to high tension battery through the high resistance R, and the cylinder is connected to the negative terminal of the high tension battery. Now we will see the working of this Geiger-Müller counter. When ionization particle or radiation enters the counter, it ionizes the gas inside the chamber and produces positively charged ions and electrons in pairs along its path in the chamber. As you know, when the ionization enters into the chamber, here ionization takes place, and positive charged ions and electrons pairs will produce in the chamber. The central wire W, acting as anode, attracts the electrons, and metal chamber C, acting as cathode, attracts the positive ions. So that this attracts the positive ions chamber, and metal wire attracts the negative ions. This results in the production of ionization current, which flows through the high resistor. Due to the collection of the positive and negative charges by tungsten wire and this cylinder cathode, the current in the resistance will increase. The potential difference thus developed across R is amplified by vacuum tube circuit and is made to operate mechanical counter. In this way, simple particle can be registered. So in this way, single particle can be registered. So that the sudden pulse of discharge sweeps away the ions from the chamber, and the counter is ready to register the arrival of the next particle. So that by this way, we can count the every single particle enter into this chamber. So that the sudden pulse discharge sweeps away from the ions from the chamber, and the counter is ready to register the arrival of the next particle. The voltage characteristics of Geiger-Müller counter we can see in this figure. This is the voltage characteristic of Geiger-Müller counter. This is the plot of counting rate. This is the counting rate against the potential difference. Counting rate and potential difference. Counting rate and potential difference between these. In the figure, there will be no current or flow of charge carriers till an applied voltage. So you see here, up to this voltage, there is no current or counts. Behind this applied voltage, the counter begins to conduct, which is called the threshold voltage. This is called the threshold voltage. The starting point, starting voltage is called the threshold voltage. Up to that voltage, no counts or no current takes place. The initial value is called the threshold voltage. Behind this applied voltage, no counts takes place. So that the counter begins to conduct, which is called as threshold voltage. If the voltage exceeds the threshold voltage, the counter begins to conduct rapidly till a region called the plateau region. So after threshold voltage, it reaches very fastly up to a plateau region. This is called the threshold of plateau. And this region is called the GM region or operating region or GM Geiger plateau, or this is the operating point between R1 and R2. This is the voltage V1 and this is V2. This is R1 and this is R2. So in the plateau region, the counting rate is more or less independent of the applied voltage. Behind the plateau region, if the voltage is further increased, the continuous discharge is replaced. This is the region of continuous discharge. After breakdown voltage, after plateau region, if you increase the voltage, continuous discharge takes place. This is called the discharge, continuous discharge region. This we cannot like it. This is not required. So like this, the GM counter characteristics we can draw. In this characteristics, we have to remember that at a certain voltage counting rate or ionization takes place, the starting of ionization is called the starting voltage or threshold voltage. After threshold voltage, the counting rate drastically increases up to certain voltage, that is the starting of threshold plateau. And this is in this region, it is independent of the, almost independent of the applied voltage. This region is called the GM plateau or Geiger plateau. This is called the operating region. After this operating region, if you increase the voltage, this will take place. So that this region is called the continuous discharge region. Now the efficiency of the counter, if you see, it is defined as the observed counts per second to the number of ionizing particles enter into the counter. How many particles are counted by the machine to the how many ionizing particle entering into the counter is called the efficiency of the counter. So that counting efficiency defines the ability of its counting. If at least one ion pair is produced in it, the counting efficiency epsilon is equal to 1 minus e to the power of SLP, where S is the specific ionization at 1 atmosphere, P and P is equal to pressure in atmosphere, L is equal to path length of the ionization particle. So the efficiency of a GM counter as a function of pressure of air and hydrogen. So now we will discuss the advantages of Geiger-Müller counter. Geiger-Müller counter is widely used to detect and count each individual particle separately. This is used to count each individual particle separately. It is very useful for counting beta particle. Geiger-Müller counter is essentially useful for beta particle, but it can also be used for measuring gamma ray intensity. Third, the counter setup is portable and carried in hand to any place. The setup of this counter is carrying any place. It is very simple and portable. And fourth, it can be used in cosmic ray research and mineral exploration, so that we can use it in cosmic ray research and mineral exploration. And fifth, as the pulse height is constant over range of applied voltages, the power supply does not have to be precisely regulated as it for the proportionally counter, so that as the pulse height is constant over range of applied voltages in GM region, thus power supply does not have to be precisely regulated as we regulated in proportional counter. Sixth advantage is the pulses are several volts in height, which makes amplifiers unnecessarily. Already it is several, it has pulses have several volts in height, so that there is no need of amplifiers for this Geiger-Müller counter. Even though there are some disadvantages, the disadvantages are, it is insensitive for a period of 200 to 400 microsecond following each pulse, which prevents its use at very high counting rates. So that it is insensitive in a period of 200 to 400 microseconds following each pulse. This causes to its use at very high counting rates. It can, the second disadvantage is, it can only count the number of particles but cannot give any other information such as charge, momentum, energy, range about the particles. This is the second disadvantage. Now we will move to scintillation counter. This is the block diagram of scintillation counter. You see, this is the, before discussing this construction of the block diagram, we will discuss the principles behind this scintillation counter. Is, as you know, when high energy charged particles are radiation processed through the active fluorescent material like zinc sulfate or barium platinum cyanide, like this, some of its atoms are excited. When these excited atoms return to ground state, photons are emitted. The intensity of light flash so produced depends on the energy given by the charged particle. These flashes are converted into amplified electrical pulses by means of photomultimeter tube. The electrical pulses are then recorded electronically. The process by which energy of the instant particle is converted into light, the basic, this is the basic principle of the scintillation counter. So that in the scintillation counter, the principle is, when the radiation incident on the fluorescent material like zinc sulfate and barium platinum cyanide, this is the, here we are using sodium iodide, this is the fluorescent material. When the radiation incident on this fluorescent material, the atoms will excite it to the higher level. When they comes to the ground state, certain amount of energy is released in the form of the light, in the form of the flash. This flash is recorded by the photomultiplier tube. By this, this is the principle involved in the scintillation counter, so that this is called the scintillation counter. So that the formula is simple. When the radiation incident on the fluorescent material, by taking this energy, they will, the atoms will move to the excited state. When they comes to ground state, certain amount of energy will be released in the form of flashlight. This flashlight will be collected and counted in a photo multiplier tube, and also which is connected to measuring device. So if you see the construction, the scintillation chamber, this is the scintillation chamber, and photo multiplier tube, this is the photo multiplier tube, and consist of measuring device or electronic counter. The scintillation chamber consists of aluminium casing in which a suitable scintillation crystal is placed, so that fluorescent scintillation material is placed in this aluminium casing. The aluminium case shields the crystal from the outside light. Why we are placed in aluminium casing means it shields the light from the other sources. Scintillation chamber is fitted to the photo multiplier tube. This is the photo multiplier tube. In this photo multiplier tube, we have several electrode called the dianodes. This is dianode 1, dianode 2, dianode 3, dianode 4. Like that, the photo multiplier tube called the dianodes. This collects the charge. Now photoelectrons emitted due to photoelectric effect. The photo multiplier tube has several electrodes are called dianodes, to which progressively high potentials are applied. The electrons emitted from the photo cathode is accelerated towards the first dianode. This is the first dianode, D1. When these electrons hit D1, secondary electrons are emitted. These electrons further accelerated towards the secondary dianode, D2. From D2, the electrons further multiplied by the secondary emission. So like this, this process is repeated at each dianode, resulting a large multiplication of electron. So that this is called photo multiplier tube. Finally, highly amplified electrical pulses strikes the anode, acting as a collector. These pulses are fed into the electronic counter where they are counted. This measuring counted. The scintillation counter can count up to 10 power 16 particles per second. So that like this scintillation counters works. The scintillation counters has many advantages over the other detectors. If you see the advantages, number one, they have high efficiency. Number two, short terms of rise and recovery. Number three, large life of usage. Number four, high resolving power. Due to this, this can be used in widely in detecting and counting the radiation. And disadvantages is overall efficiency is low because of the complex nature of phenomena, that is conversion of radiation into light. Here it should convert the radiation into light, then only the light pulses will give the secondary emission and the ionization that will measured by the counter. So that this involve a complex phenomena, that is conversion of radiation into light, and the conversion into electron is very complex process. This is the only disadvantage we can found in the scintillation counter. And also we have to discuss about the Wilson cloud chamber and solid state detectors. This is the block diagram of the Wilson cloud chamber. The basic principle of Wilson cloud chamber is based on the principle of supercooled vapor condenses only on nuclei like dust particles or ions, and if the ions are not present, they remain in supersaturated vapor state, which is the most unstable. That is, they do not condense. In Wilson cloud chamber, ions act as nuclei for condensation of supersaturated water vapor. The ions are produced by the passage of high energy particles like alpha, beta, and gamma radiations through this chamber. This formation of the condensation could be in ionized air forms the basic principle of the cloud chamber. So this is the block diagram of cloud chamber. There are two types of Wilson cloud chambers are there. One is expansion type cloud chamber, diffusion type cloud chambers. So this is the construction, and this can be used for the, if you see the advantages of cloud chamber, we can use it to study the radioactive radiations, cosmic rays, positrons, neutrinos, and artificial transmutation. And by counting drops in cloud track, specific ionization can be determined. The tracks of ionizing particles can be recorded on a photographic plate using cloud chamber. The fourth advantage is by applying magnetic field on moving particle inside the chamber, its momentum energy also can be determined. Fifth, by seeing the direction of the curve of the track in the magnetic field, sign of the charge of ionizing particles also can be determined. Sixth, the cloud chamber has led to the discovery of many elementary particles like positron and meson. The disadvantages are, one is not always sure of the sense of track photograph. Number two, if the range of ionizing particle exceeds the dimension of the chamber, the tracks of such particles cannot be photographed. Number three, this cannot directly record the track of electrically neutral particle like neutron. Number four, there remains a certain amount of uncertainty about the nature of the nuclei. Number five, the limitation of the cloud chamber lies in the fact that it needs a definite time interval to recover after an expansion. Hence, it is not possible to have a continuous record of events taking place in the chamber. Now we will move to solid state detector. This is the block diagram of solid state detector. Solid state detector essentially possess a PN diode. This is the P-type silicon and this is N-type. So the diode is formed by the depositing a N-type silicon on a P-type silicon. This is the P-type silicon deposited by N-type silicon. So contact is made with P-type silicon layer by thin evaporated film of gold. So you see, this is the gold, this is N-type silicon, is filled with the gold, while other P-type silicon is coated with the metallic plating. So here the metallic coating is. In order to minimize the current flow in the detector, when no radiation is striking it, a reverse bias diode is always used. This is in reverse bias. The positive bias is applied to the gold film. So this is positive bias is applied to gold film, which will push all the positive charge carriers away from the junction and produce the depletion layer as indicated in the figure. Depletion layer contains almost no carriers on the side. The working, if you see, when an energetic charged particle. When energetic charged particle travels through the depletion layer, this is the depletion layer, its interaction with the electrons in the crystal produces electron hole pair. When the radiation entered into this depletion layer, the due to the interaction of these particles with the layer produces the electron hole pair. For every 3 electron volt of energy lost by the charged particle, these electrons and volts are swept away by the applied electrical field and registered as a voltage pulse over the resistor R. The number of charge carriers produced in a semiconductor material is approximately 10 times as large as the number of ion pairs produced as a gas ionized chamber. That is, energy extended per pair is about 3.5 electron volt in silicon compared to about 30 electron volts for gases. The voltage pulse will therefore be about 10 times larger, hence this detector has much better energy resolution than other radiation detectors. In solid state detectors, the silicon has been used mostly because of its low intrinsic conductivity. This means that detector can be operated at room temperature without excessive leakage current. For gamma ray detection, germanium detectors are much better than the silicon because of large density of germination. So this is the construction and working of solid state detector. As we discussed, this is the PN type silicon, this is P type silicon, then this is N type silicon, this is coated with gold film, and this is the metal wire. This is used in a reverse bias so that depletion region, in the depletion region, when the particle enters, it creates the ion, electron and hole pair. This will be collected through this R. Like this, we can detect the radiation. So if you see the advantages, it is very useful for highly penetrating radiation like gamma rays. Second, energy required for creation of ion pair in solids much smaller as compared to air or gases. Number three, the particle ranges is less than the junction thickness, then the pulse height is proportional to kinetic energy of the incident particles. Number four, high counting rates are possible. Number five, the rise time of pulse is very small, which makes them more suitable in coincidence experiments. Number six, these do not require any window for allowing the particle to enter. Number seven, the applied voltage and as well as size and weight of these counters are considerably small. These are the advantages of the solid state detectors. So thank you for watching. This is about the counters, as we discuss about the counters. In this examination, the question will come on the any counter like proportional counter, GM counter, Wilson curve chamber, or scintillation counter, or solid state counters. You have to explain the construction, principle, and working, and the advantages and disadvantages you have to write in the examination. Thank you for watching. If you like my video, please subscribe my channel Dr. J.C. Babu and press the bell icon to get the subsequent notification. Thank you.